Good almost end of your morning. Good almost afternoon. We need to get started with a long time song anthem of people who work for justice from the prophet Micah. What does our God require of you? That's our question. You're invited to ask this question with me. What does our God require of you? Justice, kindness, walk humbly with our God.
Justice, kindness, walk humbly with your God. Justice, kindness, walk humbly with our God. Justice, kindness, walk humbly with your God.
Good. So now, who likes to ask the questions? The people in the right of the house or the people in the left of the house? This is not a political question. This is just for us today. How about the people in the right of the house on this side? If you're on the right side, will you raise your hand? Just here in our spot. All right. Good, good. So you're going to ask the question, which goes,
what does our God require of you?
If you did not ask the question, you're going to be answering the question. Raise your hand if you're answering the question today. Those on the left of the house. If you're going to sit, then sit with a lot of enthusiasm, okay? Otherwise, stand up. Let's get the question going. 2, 3, go.
What does our God require of you?
Let's answer them. Keep going. Question. Right? So let's trade places. If you are on the left side of the house this time, raise your hand. If you're on the left side, you're going to ask the question. Okay? So you're going to sing it like this.
What does our God require of you? What does our God require of you? What does our God require of you? What does our God require of you?
You're on the right side of the house. Answer the question.
Justice, kindness, walk humbly with your God. Justice, kindness, walk humbly
Now, General Conference provides us opportunities for lots of things. We're very grateful for the opportunity to worship together. Amen? Now, there is unfortunately unrest that comes with being here. And so we don't always feel peaceful in our hearts, but we know that peace is a discipline, that God fills us with peace when all we do is ask. Amen?
Amen.
So we like to sing so that during the times where we don't feel peaceful, we can keep praying that God will fill our hearts with God's peace. So we can sing like this. Come and fill our hearts with your peace. You alone, O God, are holy. Come and fill our hearts with your peace. Hallelujah. Come and fill our hearts with your peace. You alone, O God, are holy. Come and fill our hearts with your peace.
Be the band of healing.
Marcus Briggs Cloud of the Muskogee peoples, whose traditional homelands we are in, sends us this welcome. Our ancestors still remain in this land, the land on which you find yourself now standing. Pause. Listen to the ancestors. The knowledge transmitted from their presence may help transcend false understandings of indigenous peoples. What you hear may shake up Eurocentric ideology long deemed superior, to which we so convincingly subscribe. Listening may overturn the fear of deviating from a way of being in the world that conflicts with the one we currently embrace. If you listen, you will hear a new language. The key to access a worldview where we find ecological understandings that perceive Earth as a feminine and sacred, not to be commodified or exploited in the name of capitalism. If you listen, you will witness attitudes of hospitality, generosity, and ceremony, absent of colonial borders that seek to keep the other from entering our space and taking part in our life of reciprocity and sustainability. Neighbors, hear the good news of liberation. As you enter into communion with one another and with all the other living beings around you in the homelands of the Muskogee people, I invite you to make yourselves vulnerable to hear the voices of the ancestors, that you might learn more about our ways as we continue our long-time knowledge of yours. In the name of a genderless creator, the great medicine maker of Nazareth, and the spirit that is beyond our human imposition, peace be with you all.
To look at your bulletins for the words to Who is my mother? Who is my brother? It's on page one.
From the west, the north, and the south.
Gathered in the presence of the Holy One.
Bringing our joy and sorrow with comfort and with trepidation.
We come together in this place.
To those who love and welcome us, and those who fear and despise us.
We proclaim the power of God working in our lives.
Once we were not a people. Now we are a people of God.
Please be seated.
Yesterday, we may have felt a little death in ourselves, but today is a day for resurrection. Amen? take in this creed of justice that we will read for you this morning. Breathe in and live in as we begin a second week of General Conference, where we say we are here, we are United Methodist, and we're going nowhere. Hi, Bishop. This is adapted from the Love of God and Neighbor proposal that we submitted. Listen. We are people committed to following Jesus Christ to embody God's love and justice through the United Methodist Church.
We believe in a church that passionately works for racial justice. We believe in a church that embodies full inclusiveness. We believe in a church that celebrates people of all gender identities as equally created in God's image and blessed with gifts and graces for leadership and ministry.
We believe in a church that yearns to be global and connectional and addresses the residual structures of colonialism. We believe in a church that ensures peaceful pursuit of self-determination and religious expression.
We believe in a church that proclaims the stewardship of creation joyfully and without reservation as an expression of social and ecological holiness. We believe in a church that strives for the economic justice called for in the scriptural witness, for fair scales and honest weights, to provide for the stranger, widow, and orphan, to forgive debts, and to live into the Jubilee.
Amen. We invite you to join us together in this next hymn. The words are familiar Charles Wesley words and theology, but the tune is different. I invite you to listen to the tune and then join us singing.
Christ, from whom all blessings flow, perfecting the saints below, he is who thy nature share, who thy mystic body. Still receive a mind, still arise.
the Word of God as recorded in the Gospel of Matthew. You have heard it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your God in heaven. For God makes the sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Maker is perfect. This is the word of God.
Amen. Thanks be to God. Now, how many Portuguese speakers do we have in the house? Okay, I've got a couple of folks. All right, you're going to be very, very helpful to us. Wonderful. How many? Anyone who's been to Mozambique? Anyone who's from Mozambique? All right, good. They won't know if we're doing it wrong. Okay, this creed talks about what it means to be a Methodist. This creed came back with a group of ours from Shenandoah University who went to Mozambique, met some amazing people. They learned, they taught, and they brought back a lot of music that we are grateful to have with us today. This particular song talks about how we as Methodists are the people, as Wesleyan people, we are the ones who learn how to be inclusive. We are the ones who learn how to be accepting of all people. We are the ones, because we are willing to learn and to teach, who are ambassadors of Christ in our world. Now, we are singing this into truth.
Good afternoon, my sisters and brothers. we've been busy this weekend. Most of us don't quite know what time of the day it is. I had to check my watch to be sure. I greet you in the name and in the spirit of Jesus Christ. We are in for a rare treat this afternoon. It is my distinct honor and privilege to say a few words and to present to you our speaker. If you look in the back of the program, you will see a brief bio about him. You can read that for yourself. But I want to add just a few things. You may not know it, but he is a fellow Methodist. He is from the African Methodist Episcopal Church. And in this general conference, there is a proposal that we as the United Methodist Church will affirm full communion with all of our sisters and brothers, a part of the Methodist tradition in the U.S. And what that means is there will be the free exchange of clergy and ministries of leadership between our churches without going through all of the previous hoops that we have had to put our sisters and brothers through when making the exchange. It's not a merger, but it is full communion. Dr. Cohn is no stranger to most of us. He's written 13 books. And when the Reconciling Ministers Network and all of those who are a part of the Common Witness, the Coalition for the Love Your Neighbor campaign, were thinking about someone to come to lift our spirits, to speak truth to us, and to help us understand what it means to be living in a time when some of us are still experiencing the lynching tree. What has happened to a lot of us during these past few days, I'm sure that's the way we feel. But I think he has a word for those who feel that they're dying on the lynching tree, that even death cannot keep truth from being shared. His most recent book is The Cross and the Lynching Tree. And it is that he has come to share his thoughts and his wisdom with us today. We might call him a speaker, a preacher, whatever. We know that we are in for a rare treat. Join me in welcoming and greeting Dr. James Cohn, who is our speaker.
I am very pleased to be invited to speak at this worship service of recognition, affirmation, and hope, and to support in whatever way I can your neighbor, love your neighbor coalition. I have heard about what has happened to you this week. But I say to you, you may be down, but you're not out. And And I will speak today about a people, my people, who were down many times in our 400 years of struggle for justice. But we refuse to let our enemies have the last word. Because we must remember the cross comes before the resurrection. And today may be your cross, but tomorrow you will be resurrected. And I want to speak to you today out of my people's history on the theme, the cross and the lynching tree. And call your attention to the Acts 10:39. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. The cross and the lynching tree are separated by nearly 2,000 years. One is the universal symbol of the Christian faith, and the other is the quintessential symbol of black oppression in America. Though both are symbols of death, one represents a message of hope and salvation, while the other signifies the negation of that hope by white supremacy. Despite the obvious similarities between Jesus' death on the cross and the death of thousands of black men, women, strung up to die on a lamppost or tree, relatively few people have explored their symbolic connections. Yet I believe that this is the challenge we must face. What is at stake is the credibility and the promise of the Christian gospel and the hope that we may heal the wounds of racial violence that continue to divide our churches and our society today. Now, I have spent a lifetime pointing out the hypocrisy and the mendacity of the white church in a white-dominated society, while lifting up and exhausting the voices and experiences of the oppressed. I speak and I write out of my experience as an African-American growing up in a segregated state of Arkansas and a close association with the civil rights and black power movements in the 1960s as defined by Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X. But more importantly, I speak and write out of a deep theological conviction that the true power of the Christian gospel is its unambiguous call for liberation from the forces of oppression and a fierce and uncompromising condemnation of those who oppress. I speak and I write on behalf of those whom the Salvadorian theologian and martyr Ignacio Ella Curia called the crucified people of history. I write for the forgotten and the abused, for the marginalized and the despised. I write for those who are penniless and jobless, landless, and those who have no political or social power. I speak and I write for gays, for lesbians, bisexuals, and those who are transgender, the queer people of this world. I write for the undocumented farm workers toiling in misery in our nation's agricultural fields. I write and speak for Muslims who live under the terror of war and empire in Iraq and Afghanistan. And I speak and write for all people who care about humanity. I believe that until we, especially preachers, theologians, and Christians, until we can see the cross and the lynching tree together, until we can identify Christ with a re-crucified body hanging from a lynching tree, or a gay body on a picket fence, there can be no genuine understanding of Christian identity in America or the world, and no deliverance from the brutal legacy of slavery and white supremacy and homophobia and what all those evils that kill and exploit human beings on this earth. As I started reading about lynching in America and about the historical situation of crosses in Rome during Jesus' time, my question was, how did African Americans survive and resist the lynching terror? How did they do it? There were nearly 5,000 African American men, women, and children who were lynched in America following the Civil War, and their devastated families were left behind to cope with the great loss. To live every day under the terror of death was no easy matter. I grew up in Arkansas, a lynching state. I know from experience something about lynching. I watched my mother and father deal with it. But the moment I read about it, examining it historically, I had to ask, how did blacks survive? How did they keep their sanity in the midst of all that terror? I discovered, as strange and as paradoxically as it may appear, it was the cross. It was their faith in Jesus' cross. Their faith in Jesus' cross, believing that if God was with Jesus, God must be with us because we are up on the cross too. My other question was, how could white Christians who say they believe that Jesus died on the cross to save them, how could they then turn around and put blacks on the crosses and crucify them just like the Romans crucified Jesus? That was an amazing paradox to me. African Americans use faith to survive and to resist, while whites use their faith in order to terrorize black people. Two communities, both Christian, embracing the same faith. Whites even did lynchings on church grounds. How could they do it? That's where my passion comes from as I write and talk about the cross and the lynching tree. That's where the paradox comes from in my writings. That's where the theological wrestling comes from. Like Jacob wrestling with a man until daybreak, refusing to let go until he was blessed. Many Christians embrace the conviction that Jesus died on the cross to save humankind from sin. Taking our place, we say, Jesus suffered on the cross and gave his life as a ransom for many. The cross is the great symbol of the Christian narrative of salvation. Unfortunately, during the course of 2,000 years of Christian history, the cross as a symbol of salvation has been detached from the ongoing suffering and oppression of human beings, the crucified people of history. The cross has been transformed into a harmless, non-offensive ornaments that Christians wear around their necks. Rather than reminding us of the cost of discipleship, it has become a form of cheap grace, as Dietrich Bonhoeffer put it, an easy way to salvation that doesn't force us to confront the power and the meaning of Christ's message and mission. In reflecting on the cross and the lynching tree, I found my inspiration in the Black church, along with writers such as James Baldwin, Albert Camus, and Richard Wright, as well as in the great blues artists of my youth. These artists and writers gave me a sense of awe in the presence of suffering humanity, fighting for justice against great odds. I saw that for most ordinary blacks, it was the religion and the blues that offered them sources of hope, that there was more to life than what one encountered daily in the white man's world. In the words of the great poets and writers, and in the great blues singers, and in the thunderous voices of the Black church, I discovered those who were able to confront the bleak circumstances of their lives, and yet defy fate and suffering and make the most of what living life had to offer them. Through these connections, I found my voice as a theologian, which birthed forth in my first book, Black Theology and Black Power, in 1969. I understood that when people do not want to be themselves, but somebody else, that's utter despair, a sickness unto death, as Kierkegaard wrote about it. And I knew that faith informed by the blues was the one thing that white people could not control or take away from African Americans. And as the bluesman Robert Johnson put it, I got to keep moving. I got to keep moving, blues falling like hell. And the day keeps worrying me. There's a hellhound on my trail. After reading Baldwin and Camus and Richard Wright, I wanted to go back to graduate school and study literature and get another PhD at the University of Chicago in the 1960s under the tutelage of the Negro professor Nathan Scott Jr., widely regarded as the creator and the leading scholar in the field of theology and literature. Now, although Nathan Scott and I talked about it, the Black Freedom Movement was too urgent for me to return to school. America's cities were burning, and Blacks were being shot down in the school, in the streets. And I said to myself, you already have a PhD. If you ain't got nothing to say now after 6 years of graduate study, you ain't never gonna have anything to say. And I said, forget school. Sit your butt down in that chair and write what you think. Now, although I wrote a PhD dissertation on the great Swiss theologian Karl Barth, I never taught a course on him. Because I like people who talk and write about the real, concrete world where people are suffering. And unless I can feel it in my gut, I can't say it. The poor help me to say it because I feel their pain. The literary and the activist people help me to say it because they write about suffering with imagination and power. James Baldwin is my favorite. Martin King is next. Malcolm X is the third person of my trinity. The poets and the orators give me energy. Theologians talk too much about things far removed, way out there in some intellectual stratosphere which only they inhabit. They talk to each other. They give each other degrees. The real world is not out there where they live and think. So that is why I turn to the poets and to the activists. They talk to people I know and people I love, the marginalized and the poor of this world. Being a Christian is like being black. It's a paradox. A profound contradiction. You grow up black, and you can't help but wonder why whites treat you like that. It's hard to figure out, especially as an innocent child as I was growing up in Arkansas. And yet, at the same time, my mother and daddy told me, don't you hate like they hate. If you do, you will self-destruct. Hate kills the hater, and not necessarily the hated. It was my parents' faith that gave me the inner resources to transcend the brutality and see the real beauty in the tragedy of their lives. It's a mystery, a profound and deep mystery, how African Americans, after 2.5 centuries of slavery, another century of lynching and Jim Crow segregation, and yet still come out loving white people. Now, many whites who hear me talk and write like that and read my books don't think I love them, but I do. They always have a strange expression on their faces when I say that and look at me as if I must be kidding. But you see, I am very serious when I say I love white people, because the deeper the love, the more the passion, especially when the ones you love hurt you. You are their brothers and sisters, and yet they treat you like enemies. The paradox is this. In spite of slavery, lynching, and segregation, African Americans are the only people, are the people who never organized to take down America. We have fought in every war of America, even when we weren't wanted. We have sacrificed our lives and for our nation and for the church that despised us. Yet, no matter what they do to us, we still come out whole, still searching for that transcendent meaning that whites cannot take away. I think the resources for survival and resistance in oppression are found in Black culture and religion, our faith and culture, the blues and the spirituals, gave us a sense that we were not what others said we were. The cross is a paradoxical religious symbol because it inverts the world's value system with the good news that hope comes by way of defeat, that suffering and death do not have the last word, that the last shall be first and the first last. The idea is absurd to the intellect, yet profoundly real in the spiritual lives of the Black religious experience. For those who were lynched, the crucified Christ manifests God's loving and liberating presence in the contradictions of Black life. The cross of Jesus is that transcendent presence in the lives of Christians which empower them to believe that ultimately in God's eschatological future, they will not be defeated by the troubles of this world. No matter how great and painful their suffering, this paradox, this absurd faith, was the only possible one for those who were powerless, who were unable to be, who were unable to be proud and mighty. One who understood that people are not called to be ruled over by others. The cross of Christ is God's critique of power with powerless love, snatching victory out of defeat. What I am talking about actually is about love. It's something you cannot prove empirically or articulate adequately, but the truth of it is self-evident in living it. I have seen the transforming power of this faith in the cross among many Black Christians who struggle, especially among the Black freedom fighters in the civil rights movement. Many knew that they were going to be beaten and tortured and possibly even killed. They knew that they were not going to win the obvious way of winning, but they had to do what they did because the transcendent reality encountered in their fight for justice was more powerful than their opposition, more meaningful than that which contradicted it. People respond to what empowers them inside, that spirit that lets them know that they are somebody when the world treats them as nobody. When you can act out of that spirit, then you know there is a reality in this world bigger than you. And that's what Black religion bears witness to. In all of its flaws, it bears witness to a spiritual resource that empowers marginalized people to do things that seem impossible. I grew up with that. I really don't ever remember wishing I was white, because being black was so wonderful and beautiful, especially as I saw blackness embodied in my mother and father and in the host of other black men and women in Arkansas. There may have been moments when I might have had the desire to be white may have crossed my mind, but I don't remember. The reality of love in my own community was so strong that I did not have time to think about being white. The spiritual values of my parents and other blacks were much more important than the material things I saw in the white community that hated me. Black music, black preaching, black loving, black dancing, everything black was much more interesting and inspiring. Blackness saved me from whiteness. And kept me sane, believing that I was somebody no matter what people did to me. How do people know that they are not what the world says when they have so few political and social resources to defend their humanity? So few economic resources to even physically survive, and so few educational resources in order to express their somebodyness. For blacks in the U.S., it was their faith, which is inseparable from their culture. That was why I call the blues secular spirituals. The blues are spiritual resources, a cultural power that enables people to express their humanity. James Baldwin only finished high school. Richard Wright only the ninth grade. And they had their say and bore witness to a transcendence in blackness that no one could destroy. Blackness is the image of God in black people. It is the light in the white darkness. B.B. King never got out of grade school. And Louis Armstrong hardly went to any school at all. Now I said to myself, if Louis Armstrong could blow a trumpet like that, forget it. I'm going to write theology the way Louis Armstrong blows that trumpet. And the way Billie Holiday sings Strange Fruit. I want to reach deep down in my black being for those cultural, spiritual resources that enable African Americans to express themselves when the world said they had nothing to say. People who resist create hope and love of humanity. The civil rights struggle was a mass movement that was defined by love. You always have both sides. You always have bad faith and good faith. I like to speak and write about the good faith. Faith that resists. Faith that empowers. faith that enables people to look another in the eye and tell them what you think. Now, I remember growing up in Arkansas. There were a lot of masks. As Paul Lawrence Dunbar put it, we wear the mask that grins and lies. I wore a mask in Arkansas as a child when I went to white people's town in Bearden and other places, but I didn't wear one in my own community. I wore a mask in the white community because I knew what they could do to you and your family. I wore a mask even in graduate school because I had to find a way to excel in an academic environment that did not acknowledge my black existence. But I kept saying to myself, one of these days, I'm going to take that mask off and say what I think to white people and make up for lost time. And so, the last 40-something years, that's what I've been doing. I write and encourage African Americans to get in touch with that inner spiritual resource, that empowering spirit, in order that you may have your say and say it as clearly and as forcefully and as truthfully as you can. Not all blacks could do that because white people have a lot of power. And many white churches exist, but most are not the real thing. They are just loving each other. People in their own group, excluding others. That's all they do, is socialize with each other, at least most of the time. You seldom find a church that has any diversity in it. Now, how can that be Christian? That's why I'm glad at this service. It's diverse. God was in Christ reconciling the world unto God's self. Well, it was in the white churches that the white God and a white Christ enslaved and separated blacks from the white community. Today, black and white churches are doing the same thing, excluding queer people from their community, saying, I love the sinner, hate the sin. Now, I never heard Jesus say that. Like saying, I love black people, but I don't want them in my community. I don't want them in my church. But I say, as long as you are silent and do nothing about homophobia and white supremacy and all these other evils, you are just as guilty as the one who hung black on trees and queer people on picket fences. Just like Peter was silent when the Romans hung Jesus on the cross. Black Simon took up the cross that Simon Peter was supposed to bear. If you are going to worship somebody that was nailed to a tree, you must know that the life of a disciple of that person is not going to be easy. You may end up on a tree too. Just like Jesus, blacks and gays that whites and straight people despise. And so in this sense, we have to take seriously the Christian faith. or else we will end up doing the opposite of what that faith means. Now, my mother and father did not have my opportunity. And when I write and speak, therefore, I think of them and try to speak for them. They never had a chance to stand before white people and tell them what they think. I have to do it for them somehow. I try to do that all over the world. I think of Lucy and Charlie Cone and all the other Lucys and Charlie Cones who are out there, and I try to speak for them. I think of them and not of myself. I think of them and feel their spirit flowing through my body, encouraging me to speak the truth. They deepen my spirituality and give me something to hold on to that I can feel and that I can touch. It is a very spiritual experience because we are doing something for people who cannot and will never have a chance to speak for themselves. So why do I need to speak for me? I need to speak for those people, as Martin Luther King Jr. said, who have been left out of the sunlight of opportunity. If you feel passion in my voice, and if you feel energy in any books you read by me, that's because I'm thinking of Lucy and Charlie Cone, my daddy and mama, and all the other many marginalized daddies and mamas out there. And if I can do that, I think I'll stay on the right track. Amen.
God's spirit is truly in his place. What a powerful word, Dr. Cone. Amen. As I look around this room, I'm going to invite you to look around the room for a moment. As I was listening to Dr. Cone's message and just feeling the spirit, feeling the energy of the Spirit of God in this place, I said, Lord, if this is not reflective of the kingdom of God, what is? I give thanks to God for this time of worship, for this time of meeting together. We come from many different places, and we are very different one from another, but we are one body, God's beloved community. We are the body of Christ. And what binds us together is the love of Christ that abides in each and every one of our hearts. And it's that love that will transform this church. It is that love bound together, just as we are in this room, that would move this church that we all love, to being a church that is fully inclusive, where all are welcomed. And when we say all, we truly mean all. I am so thankful to God for the Common Witness Coalition. I'm thankful to God for the Love Your Neighbor campaign, because it's because of those efforts, it's because of that coalition that an event like today is made possible. All of the activities, all of the planning, all of the strategizing, all of the witnesses that have taken place before General Conference, and even as we are gathered here for these 2 weeks, have been made possible because of this coalition's efforts. But friends, we know with any effort, it requires funding, amen? Amen. And we are a people who are rich in spirit, and we are a people who are rich in resources, amen? Amen. Because we serve a God, not one of scarcity, but one of abundance. Can I get an amen? Amen. So I'm going to invite you in these moments to dig deep into your pockets. I want your love of God and your love of neighbor to now be worked out through your offering. I want you to dig deep in your pockets. If you came prepared with your checkbooks as I did, I want you to get that envelope out of your bulletin. I want you to fill out this envelope, and I want you to pray and ask yourself, what is God calling me to do? What is God calling me to give to help make these efforts possible, that we can move the church to truly be the church? So let your offering this day be your personal witness. You can fill out the form. You can make your checks payable to Reconciling Ministries Network. We are a coalition. We are the body. Let us be the church as we serve the church through our offerings this morning. Give joyfully, but give generously. Amen.
Save. 5 in your bulletin.
Christ invites us all, everyone, to gather around the table where we remember and renew our vow to love God, love ourselves, and love our neighbor. We have asked this question over and over again. Who is our neighbor? Who deserves our love, our mercy, our attention, our welcome, our justice making? A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when saw him, was so moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper and said, "Take care of this beloved one. And when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend." Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? We are all capable of showing mercy, justice, and love to all we meet.
This is the table where we open ourselves . This is the table where we open ourselves to God's abundant love, igniting our passion for our neighbors, everyone we meet, wherever we go. Christ invites us all, everyone, neighbors in heart and mine, to join here together. But first, we empty ourselves out so that we may be filled up.
You are God's beloved ones. Turn to your neighbors and share signs of mercy and love. This is a community that accepts all. Let us pass the peace.
souls inspire, and lighten with celestial fire. Thou the anointing spirit art, who dost thy sevenfold gifts impart. Thy blessed unction from above is comfort, life, and fire of love. Enable with perpetual light the dullness of our blinded sight. Teach us to know, Creator Christ, and Thee of both to be but one, that through the ages all along, this may be our endless song.
Jesus brought us the only answer that we need. We are to love each other as God loves us. All of us are neighbors in the household of God. On the last night, when Jesus was taken away, He gathered us up and reminded us that through God's mighty acts, we would be set free.
Alleluia, alleluia.
And said, "Eat this to remember me, and share it with everyone you meet. This bread will save your life."
When he had eaten, Jesus took the cup and blessed it and gave it to us and said, drink from this, all of you. This is God's overflowing blessing poured into you always. Drink it and remember me.
Together the words that Jesus taught us to pray in your own language. Let us pray. Our Father,
generous God, pour your Holy Spirit into these everyday elements and make them be for us holy food. Pour your Spirit unto us, everyday people, and let us be holy people for your works of mercy, justice, and love. This is the bread that makes us one. This is the cup that makes us whole.
Thank you. speak so God can use me
to justice.
We pledge to make a just church our reality
by working for racial justice and resisting exploitive systems that teach racial ethnic superiority and inferiority.
Building public expressions of inclusiveness and affirmations of diversity in our churches and societies.
Welcoming gender diversity and establishing policies and practices that share power across gender lines.
Including lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender persons in our membership and ministry.
Supporting seminaries, mission institutions, and global partners in providing inclusive and shared leadership.
Supporting the work with women, children, and youth by United Methodist Women and the Women's Division.
Seeking to honor and to reconcile our differences, speaking respectfully with one another in love.
Grounding our ministries in a broad understanding of church, community, environment, and the world.
Acting on reducing carbon, radiation, and other pollutants while refusing to give in to cynical despair.
Documenting and announcing specific action toward these commitments to encourage others.
Living our Wesleyan tradition as people of the warmed heart, enlightened mind, and extended hand.
Being United Methodists who embrace our unity in Christ, even in the midst of diverse opinions.
Shaping our lives according to the good news of Jesus Christ, the Word of God made visible in our midst.
Amen.
Will you repeat after me?
God bless you and keep you.
God's face
upon you.
Shine on you.